moments prior, we are going to play or celebrate forever. And this is a language from my tribe of Accra, Ghana. It's called Ga. And I'm going to sing it, and then we can read on the call and respond from that. And then we're going to have the drummers follow us, you know, on the drum as well. So, you can just repeat after me. Nyong Che Re.
Nyong Che Re.
Nyong Che Re.
Nyong Che Re.
Ni Eje.
Ni Eje.
Ni Eje.
Ni Eje.
Wok Ba Shre.
Wok Ba Shre.
Wok Ba Shre.
Wok Ba Shre.
Wok Ba Bo.
Wok Ba Bo.
Wok Ba Bo.
Walk
back, bo.
Walk back, bo.
Nyong Cherry.
Nyong Cherry.
Nyong Cherry.
Nyong Cherry.
Ni Eje.
Ni Eje.
Ni Eje.
Ni Eje.
Walk back, Shre.
Walk back, Shre.
Walk back, Shre.
Walk back, Shre.
Walk back, bo. This is how it goes. Nyong Chere Ni Eje. And then we respond to that the same thing. Nyong Chere Ni Eje. Nyong Chere Ni Eje. And
Nyong Chere Ni Eje.
Nyong Chere Ni Eje.
Nyong Chere Ni Eje.
Waba Shre Waba.
Thank you. number?
G-A, God.
The language is G-A, God, the language of God. Do you remember where it's from? Ghana. Do you remember where in Ghana it's from? Do you know what the capital of Ghana is?
No.
Theo, help them.
Okay, so the capital of Ghana is A-C-C-R-A, Accra.
Accra, A-C-C-R-A. The capital of Ghana is Accra. And the language Ga is from Accra, which is where Theo's home is, the city of Accra. So after church, you're going to get to, they brought some drums that they're hoping that, you know, you'll hang out and participate and learn some things. Does that sound like fun?
Yeah.
Yeah? We might even teach you some dancing.
Yes.
Woo! Awesome. All right, so I invite you to go back to your seat and to sit somewhere where you can see. So, you know, this whole front row is like totally empty. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. And at that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out. Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." He said, "Here I am." He ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call you. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called for me." But Eli said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord God called Samuel again, a third time. And Samuel got up and he went to Eli and said, "Here, I am here for you. You called me." And Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, "Go lie down. If he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there and called as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears it tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that the Lord told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also, if you hide anything from me of all that God has told you." So Samuel told Eli everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him. Let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel from Dan to Beersheba knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The Lord continued to appear at Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. Here ends our reading this morning. May God add a blessing of understanding and wisdom to our hearing.
In this story, we're going to hear a reference to the choosing of a queen mother, which may seem a little obscure to you. So I encourage you, if you want to find out more about this unusual village governance practice, to take a look at our exhibit where it's explained in part, or to talk to Jim for Marsha Christensen after church. I am Mrs. Angelica Akua Atake. My hometown is Akka in the Jossakan district of the Volta region of Ghana. I mostly encourage girl-child education. When you educate a woman, you educate a nation. I was born in Akka, a village in the northern Volta. In my village, there was no electricity, no good drinking water, no clinic, no post office or social media. I went to school without sandals and sometimes with a torn school uniform. I used to help my mother at the farm and got some cassava to sell by the roadside to raise money for education. I used part of the money to buy the forms for the teacher training exam. The day I went to take the exam, I had to walk many miles to the test location, and when I arrived, I noticed that I was the only girl in the room and the only person from my village. By God's grace, I passed the examination and I was able to graduate from teacher training college and obtain my teaching certificate. That is the beginning of my success story. At my first station, I met my husband, Prosper Adeke, who was teaching industrial arts at the same location where I was teaching primary school. Prosper was a member of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, Ghana, and I was a Roman Catholic. He was an Ewe, and I was an Ashanti. We have had a very happy marriage and have four children. We are both presbyters in the Evangelical Presbyterian Church. Later, Prosper became the executive presbyter of the National Church, and we moved to Ho. During that time, I taught kindergarten at the mission school at Ho, because Prosper's job required that I travel with him frequently. We were in charge of hospitality for any foreign visitors who were partners with our denomination. Because we were considered prosperous by the members of our family, we took on the responsibility of educating other less fortunate children. As a result, many children made up our household. At one time, there were 14. One day we received a terrible message that my brother and his wife were killed in a car accident, leaving their baby son Theophilus. Naturally, he became a member of our family and we adopted him. Several months later, Prosper and I traveled to my home village to attend the funeral of my brother and sister-in-law. The morning after the funeral, I was in the courtyard of my mother's house. It was early morning, and I was still in my night clothes when I saw several men from the village approach me. One of the men grabbed my arm and said that they were there to capture me because they wanted me to be the Queen Mother. I did not want to be the Queen Mother because I had so many children at home to educate, and Ho was a long way away. Plus, it is very expensive to be a Queen Mother. Meanwhile, an argument broke out between the men about whether I was the right one. Some thought that my sister, who had a lighter complexion, was the chosen one. Because they had not poured white powder on my head, I was still free. If they had poured the powder, I would have had no choice but to be the Queen Mother for life. While they were debating, I started running through the jungle in my bare feet and nightgown to the place in the bush where Prosper was staying. When I arrived there, Prosper said he suspected that might happen, and we quickly jumped in the car and ran home. It turned out that I was the actual candidate that the council wanted, but my sister was there, so she is now the Queen Mother, and it nearly caused her to be divorced because it was such a strain. I continued to teach for years. Eventually, I became a principal at the primary school in Penway, but the Department of Education was beginning to strengthen the teaching requirements. In order to advance myself, I realized I would need a bachelor's degree. I enrolled in the University of Cape Coast Extension in Ho. Each Saturday for 3 years, I went to classes. Finally, with the financial support of Amenyo Foundation, I received my degree in 2013. Shortly after that, I became the principal of an excellent primary school in Ho. I began rising gradually through the ranks, and by the grace of God, I am now a district director of education. During my school days, I sold cassava, gari, bread, vegetables, and fish, all by the roadside. By the grace of God, I have inspired many people in Ghana. With God, all things are possible.
My name is Amoko Fred, from Benue in the Volta region of Ghana. I am the firstborn, of which we are six in the family. That's our parents and four children. I started my junior high school education at Seven Garrison School, after which I gained admission to Bishop Herman College to study general science. I joined Amenyo Foundation in 2009, and I may say that it is as a result of them that is why I reach where I am today, and I am thankful for that. I completed senior high school in the year 2013 and passed with distinction. I like mathematics so much, so I have decided to do BS in mathematics and statistics at undergraduate level. I had an admission to the University of Cape Coast in 2014 to read BS in mathematics and statistics. I am now in level 400. Currently, I am now the unit chairman of the committee in Benue electoral area and also the president of Benue tertiary and secondary students union. I am 24 years of age.
My name is Irene Ashidabor. Sunday greetings to you as well. All began when I lost my father in 1990. My mother was just a housewife, jobless when it happened. This pushed my mother to get something doing to take care of us, since there were four of us. She got a job in Hull as a housemaid with the project director of Evangelical Presbyterian Church, national headquarters. We also needed to stay with our relatives, so she could move to Hull for her job. I completed junior high school in 1993 and went to a boarding senior high school at Hopeway, 4 hours away. I completed high school in 1996 and came to join my poor mom in Hull. When the university entrance exam results came, I failed because I couldn't have enough time to learn. Sometimes I was not permitted to attend school because of lack of school fees. The man with whom we were staying decided to help me learn some trade because I was serviceable. So I found myself in an apprenticeship at the Queen Victoria Sewing Shop as a seamstress and designer in the year 1998. During the course of the apprenticeship, the man's contract at the headquarters was finished, so he needed to leave for another person to take over. Fortunately for me, the man knew Mama, Angelica, and Prosper, so he handed me over to them so I can stay and complete my apprenticeship. They took care of me as their daughter. After the apprenticeship, I stayed with them to work for some time, when they also introduced me to Marcia Christensen to do seamstress work during her visit to Hull. One day, Mama Angelica called me and told me I need to stay on my own and begin life. In fact, it was terrible for me, but I had no choice than to rent a single room and move. The room was tiny with no window and a curtain for a door. Life began at Dome, a section of Hull, where Marcia formally visited me. In fact, I had wanted to go back to school, but there was no help from anywhere. There, I decided to give my life to Christ, since there is no one for me. I was there when a gentleman approached me and proposed marriage to me. Little did I know, he was another problem that came my way. I accepted it, thinking he would be there for me as a husband, friend, and my parent, not knowing he admired me because of my hard work. We got married. My husband refused to give me any money for our children, and he committed adultery, but that was not reason in our legal system for divorce. Because of the sewing work I did for visitors to Ghana with the Christensens and others, I was able to feed my children. Problems continued to increase from all angles, but I always say to myself, God is alive to take me through. So the more the problems, the more I pray and work for God, the more I grow in the Lord. It came to a time when I said, I want to teach, so at the end of the month I can get some money if I didn't get work sewing. By the grace of God, I was appointed and planned to upgrade myself some days. That was what God did to bring Nancy Talbot through Amenyo to help in my support. Now I begin to hear from God to do more work for him. Because I enjoy working for God, I decided to go to pastoral school in Ho and weekends to Accra for ordination. The same time I was in Pecky College of Education and received a teaching certificate. Last month, with Amenyo's support through Nancy, I graduated with a Bachelor of Science degree from the University of Cape Coast Extension in Ho, which opens the doors to higher paying teaching and administrative jobs. I now have a teaching job during the week. Now, at last, I can take care of my family on my own. Finally, I summoned the courage to kick him out of the house, and he is gone permanently. God, who has all these plans for me, brought me through successfully. In fact, I enjoy working for God so much so it's my prayer that God will bless me financially to support God's work, because I have so many works and plans for God. I have an evangelism team, we visit hospitals, and an adolescent group in the church where I teach them. I am also in charge of the Sunday school, women's ministry, and also a preacher. I also have some projects in plan, but I am waiting for God's blessing. This is how it all came about. I hope to visit your country one day. And now I can say I was a nobody, but now I am somebody.
I am Promise. I hail from Pinway, a suburb of Ho in the Volta region of Ghana. And I was born on the 16th of April, 1996. Unfortunately, my mother died when I was 3 years old, and I was told she was a traitor and the very one who always takes care of the house, since my father is just an indigent peasant farmer who could only supply farm products for the house. As a result of my mother's death, I was sent to my grandmother for her to take care of me, since my father can't take a proper care of me as a kid. When I was growing up into an adult, things were becoming so difficult for us, since we were two boys staying with our grandmother. She is just an indigent peasant farmer. My father wasn't supportive, but rather got drunk with the little money he has derived from the farm work. So payment of our school fees was always a catastrophe for us. So due to that, my brother and I have decided among ourselves to farm in a large size so that our grandmother can be selling the farm products in order to be paying our school fees and also to take care of our basic needs. But unfortunately, sometimes when the crops flourished, they were lost because it stopped raining for a long time. When the crops flourishes, we harvested a lot, and the supply exceeded the demand in the market, leading to low prices. So due to such situation, we got only what to eat in the house. We have suffered a lot, since we have to wake up at 3:30 a.m. on every market day to carry the foodstuffs on our head from Pinway to home market, which is about 15 kilometers before going to school. Because of that, we always received punishment for coming to school late on market days. And as a result of the problems we were facing, I decided to drop out of school because it was clear that there was nobody to help finance my education, even at the basic level, before thinking of the high school as well as the tertiary. So I began doing some minor work, such as fetching and selling of firewood, burning of charcoal, and cracking of stones in order to support myself. As time goes on, some of my teachers came to realize that I was not coming to school anymore. So they came to me asking me to come back to school, but my no was no. So they went ahead and told Mr. P.M.K. Atake, my situation, and he came to me telling me that the days of my predicaments are numbered, because Reverend Dr. James and Marcia Christensen, to God be the glory, I completed my basic school successfully. I didn't perform that well because I haven't studied at home before, since there's no chance to do that. I only read my notes when I come to school, because that was the only opportunity for to study something. So as a result of my performance, I got an admission into a poor high school in a remote area where they lack teachers and also teaching and learning materials. I was transferred to one of the biggest high schools in the country, which is Mwuli School, the following year by the help of Jim and his wife. And fortunately, I completed the high school as well, successfully. But I didn't perform that well in mathematics for me to get admission into the tertiary institutions, since the foundation was very poor. So I decided to register with another school in order to rewrite, but I still got a poor result as I rewrite. But yet still, I was still having the hope that I would surely make it, so I discussed with Jim, and he hired a personal math tutor for me to rewrite again. He encouraged me more. So I attended the math classes perfectly, and everything seems all right. So I wrote the exams for the third time. Still, the outcome was poor. So I became frustrated that some of the people in the village thought I was wasting resources. But one thing I like about myself is that I am a kind of person that is always focused, and I never listen to what people think or say about me, and also a kind of person that is having a strong hope. I said to myself that I will strive. Strive until I am successful, because failure today makes wise men successful tomorrow. So as a result of the hope I have, I went and told Mr. Prosper Atake that I wanted to buy a polytechnic form and apply for an admission with the results I got from the Wahala School. He asked me to do so because there's no harm in trying. Others said I would never be picked for admission. So I came back to my house in order to think about myself. And I began to shed tears because I wasn't expecting those statements from them. After thinking for a while, I went to a friend to check the closing date for me. And the closing date for the admission form was the following day. So I quickly rushed back to the house to take my bicycle in order to sell it. Unfortunately, I got a buyer who wanted to buy it, but at a low price. So I accepted the price because I wasn't having any option. So I took the money and I went ahead and bought the admission form, and I did the necessary things expected of me. In 2 months' time, they sent me a message that I had gotten admission, so I could go and print my admissions letter. So I went ahead and printed it, after which I contacted Tobe Kotoku, Paramount Chief of Penway, telling him that I have gotten an admission. He asked me to get it for him, for the admission letter, which signified that I have gotten admission. So I quickly sent it to him, and he was surprised. And later on, the necessary things were done, including the payment of the school fees and the hostel fees by help of the Menyo Foundation. And I went to school. And to God be the glory, the school was converted into a technical university the same year I went to the school. I am now in level 200 and am happy for where I am today, which I never thought possible. I want to say a very big thanks to Merrill Forrest, Jim and his wife, and the Menyo Foundation for their love and support right from day one. My favorite quote, and one I try to live by, follows: always work for a cause, not for applause. Live life to express, not to impress. Do not strive to make your presence noticed. Just make your absence felt. Nothing in nature lives for itself. Rivers do not drink their own water. Trees do not eat their own fruits. The sun does not shine for itself, and flowers do not spread their fragrance for themselves. Jesus did not sacrifice for himself. Living for others is a rule of nature. We were all born to help each other. No matter how difficult the situation you find yourself in, still do good for others.
Then stretch again.
Sing a call and response song again. This is called Da Da Kebe. Da Da Kebe is about brothers fighting or always, you know, bickering between, you know, brothers. You know, they always, you know, have a little push and pull, and you know, another brother, you know, to, you know, stop it, you know, stop it. To be together. So that's what the song is about. Always bickering, but no more, you know, bickering anymore. So I'm gonna say the words and we'll recite it together before I'm gonna sing the song. So it goes like this: Da da ke be.
Da da ke be.
Da da ke be.
Da da ke be.
So it goes like this. Da da ke be, and then your response is the same.
Da da ke be.
Da da ke be.
Thank you. in desperation for the state of the world as we consider the too many places where there is danger and there is fear, where there is anxiety and there is uncertainty. And so among them, indeed, are still the people of Las Vegas, the people of Northern California, the people of Puerto Rico, the people of North Korea, the people of Iran, and all of the places in between and throughout. May we indeed offer and find our prayers for peace and our prayers for reconciliation, that we find the wisdom of knowing we need not be brothers and sisters who bicker all the time. I want to share with you a joy. Peggy Carlson has a new grandchild. Avery Morgan Liberty was born yesterday, and so beautiful arrival of a new granddaughter. And there's yet another one to come. Peggy is expecting two new grandchildren from two different daughters. And so our joy that Avery's here. And if you love Peggy, she has beautiful pictures on her phone of Avery. And so our joy for Sarah and for Anthony, and certainly for Peggy and the extended family. Holy and gracious God, sometimes you call to us in the night, calling us by name like you called Samuel. And sometimes we are courageous enough to say, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And sometimes we are stubborn enough to think someone else is calling for some other reason. Unstop our ears and open our hearts this day to hear your voice in the world. There is a call and a purpose for each of us in small ways and big. We are called to serve for your good and your use and your will in the world, which looks like love, which looks like compassion, which looks like reconciliation, which looks like stretching to learn a new rhythm, a new place, a new music, a new sound. For it calls to us like you call to us. Samuel, Samuel, speak, for your servants are listening. May it be so. Amen.
Church, it was something I learned in Ghana.
to experience an offering in worship in Ghana is a life-changing experience. It contradicts two of the worst assumptions that we have in the American church. The first is that the offering is a collection. You can collect leaves. You can collect money. You can collect traffic tickets. But you can't collect offerings. You can only make them. And the second thing is that the offering is all about money. We monetize everything. But I remember distinctly watching the people in the Ghanaian church dance their offering to the dish pan that served as a basket. And I am sure in that cash-poor economy that many of the people who danced forward with their gift put nothing in the dish pan because they had nothing. But they still made an offering because they joined in the dance. Now already you're getting very nervous. Dancing and offering forward is not something that comes easily to a bunch of Yankees. But I want to tell you about how this happens in the Ghanaian church. First of all, you have to have drums. And as you learned this morning, drums are not just a rhythm instrument, they're musical instruments. They have soul. And the drums would start their music, and the people would rise up and dance their offering to the people who held the dish pans. And I remember distinctly one elderly gentleman dressed in what I thought was a very plain but elegant gray suit with no tie. And it was clear that he had difficulty walking. But he made his way in the procession to the offering basket. And even though he didn't flail his arms, and he didn't jitterbug, and he didn't stutter step, he moved with such rhythm. Every move, every small motion that he made was a rhythm. So I tell you that because I want you to realize that what we're about to ask you to do does not involve pirouettes and being on point or flailing around like an idiot. It simply means coming with intention, with joy, with all the rhythm of life, with all the wonder of giving thanks to God, to let the gratitude be our offering. I shouldn't say this in church, but you know, God doesn't need your money. God doesn't need your money. The church needs your money, but God doesn't need your money. What God needs, what God wants, is our thanks, is our joy, is our gratitude. So, regardless of what gift you have to give this morning of your tithes and offerings, I encourage you to join in the offering of thanks and celebration and joy in the goodness of God. John Brooks is going to stand with me, and I invite you to come to the center aisle if you're in these sections or down the side and come up and bring your offering to give to God, and we're going to have the drums inspire us.
Thank you.
All right, let us bring our offering to God. God's love is great, and if you may join me in editing a little bit. God's love is great and lasts forever. It fits the meter better. In E flat. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. God's love is great and lasts forever. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. God's love is great and lasts forever. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. God's love is great and lasts forever. Nada save them, nada save, people of God sing praise. Amen.
Call. We are marching in the light of God.